This is video 2 on the topic, how do musical instruments make sounds? In this video, you're going to be considering oscillations. This lecture is presented by your guest lecturer, Professor Joe Wolf.
Let's look at some examples of oscillations, things that produce repeated cycles of vibration and usually set up sine waves. However, we'll slow things down so that we can see them. Here, for instance, is a simple pendulum, and there are repeated cycles of sideways motion of the mass on the spring due to its motion in the Earth's gravitational field. You'll look at those in another section. However, the sort of vibrations that we'll look at in a bit more detail are those of a mass on a spring. So here's a simple example. A mass bouncing up and down on a spring, gravity pulling it down, the spring pulling it up with a force that depends on how much the spring is stretched. That motion that you see there, if we plot it as a function of time, is a sine function. It's a particularly simple sort of vibration, and physicists call it simple harmonic motion. There are lots of examples of mass spring oscillators. For instance, if I wanted to understand how a guitar works, at different times I would refer to the springiness of the string and its mass, to the springiness of the wood and its mass, and even to the springiness of the air inside the body and the mass of a lump of air located near the sound hole. So springs and masses are very important to physicists, but they're very important to almost every system that makes sound. And even when there's a sound-making system that doesn't involve a mass or a spring, it usually involves things that are analogous to those. So, worth having a close look. For a spring, we define something called the spring constant, because a small force extends the spring a bit, and a large force extends it rather more. For many springs, the extent of the spring, the deformation of the spring, and the force applied are approximately proportional, and we call that the stiffness of the spring, or the spring constant. Let's do this little experiment. At the moment, each one of these masses is 50 grams, as is the device that's carrying them. So we have 200 grams stretching this spring, and that's a weight of about 2 newtons. Let's look at the extension of the spring against the meter rule. And now I'll reduce the force. We've got 150 grams, about 1.5 newtons. 100 grams. And 50 grams. So from those three measurements, we can calculate the stiffness of the spring, the force per unit extension of the spring. Now, let's look at the oscillation. We've got 50 grams on our spring, and you can see that it's a reasonably rapid oscillation. If I put more mass on here, it's slower and slower again. So it looks as though the frequency decreases as I increase the mass. I could also change the spring. The force required to stretch a long spring a certain amount is less than the force required to stretch a short spring. So a short spring is stiffer than a long spring. So let me shorten the spring here. I'll do that just with my hand. And now, there we have short spring versus long spring. So, it looks as though the frequency depends on the ratio of the spring stiffness, which we call K, to the mass, M. However, it can't be proportional to those because of the units involved. The spring stiffness is the force in newtons required to produce an extension in meters, so it's in newtons per meter. And the newton, think back to Newton's second law, F equals ma, the newton has units of kilogram meters per second per second. Force times acceleration. So if we divide K by M, we'll get kilogram meters per second, divided by meters, divided by kilograms, so we get seconds to the minus 2. Now frequency has to be in seconds to the minus 1 cycles per second, so we would guess that the frequency is proportional to the square root of K over M. That guess is correct. The only thing is, we can't necessarily from that argument write F equals K over M. There could be a dimensionless number, a pure number, out in front of the square root. And in fact, there is. In fact, the frequency is 1 over 2 pi times the square root of K on M. Where does that 2 pi come from? Well, it comes from the cycles. If you like, we can say that simple harmonic motion like this is a projection of circular motion. If you looked at circular motion and you looked at it from the edge, it looks like simple harmonic motion. So the cycle of a vibration corresponds to one circle of circular motion, and that in a sense is where that factor 1 on 2 pi appears. All right, we've measured the stiffness of this spring. Let's now predict what its frequency would be with a mass of 100 grams there. So I'll displace it and we can count 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 oscillations, and that allows us to get an estimate of the frequency. Let's do that calculation. Another mass on spring oscillator is this bottle. I'm going to consider the air in the bottle as a spring. When I compress it, it requires a pressure and thus a force. And I'll also think about the lump of air in the neck of the bottle as a mass that is, in a sense, suspended on the spring of the air in the bottle. And you're hearing the sound of that lump of air vibrating backwards and forwards on the spring of the air in the bottle. We'll have another little example with a ruler, and for that we'll need a close-up. So, in this experiment, the ruler will be both mass and spring. If I have a long section of the ruler, it's a fairly weak spring, and if I make it short, it's a stiff spring. It takes more force to deform it the same length. So, look at the vibrations of that ruler, and as I both reduce the mass and increase the stiffness, the vibrations get faster. If I reduce it enough, we can actually hear a sound. And notice that as it gets shorter, the pitch of the sound gets higher. So, slow vibrations when the ruler is long, faster vibrations as I shorten it, and eventually, when it gets short enough to hear, I can hear that faster vibrations have higher pitch. a very simple demonstration that fast vibrations correspond to higher pitch.
Special thanks to Sebastian Frick for doing all the filming and editing of this video. If you'd like to find out more about sound or the voice, then it would be a good idea to visit these PhysClip sites. A webpage about the music group at UNSW can be found at this final address if you are interested in finding out more about this topic.